Today we're joined at the Africa Center for Strategic Studies by John Katunga, who's here to talk about the situation in the DRC and what the prospects for peace are in the DRC. John Katunga is a has been involved in peace building in the Great Lakes region of Africa for many, many years, has worked on many peace processes. He currently is the senior technical advisor for peace building for Catholic Relief Services, where he oversees peace building activities for the agency. John, we're really very, very happy to have you here at the Africa Center for Strategic Studies.
Thank you.
Now, everybody's talking about the agreement that was brokered in December by the Catholic Church. Between President Kabila and the opposition, what is the status of this process? Where do you see the process leading?
Thank you for the question. Actually, the agreement was itself based on a prior agreement that was brokered on October 18th. And supported by the African Union and the overall international community. And the result of that agreement were the basis of the 31st December agreement itself. The discussion that led to the 31st December agreement were based on the first agreement that was signed on 18th of October. And it was supported by the African Union and the regional powers and the international community. So being a cumulative agreement, the December 31st agreement was a refinement of the 18th October agreement. And it has the advantage of including, being more inclusive than the previous agreement. And it has crystallized a process to set up a new government that will lead the transition during the 12 months that were agreed upon. Now today, where that agreement is, it's still holding. The agreement is the one that is being now, the discussion are about special clauses that will accompany the agreement. The agreement offered a framework between all the political parties and all the actors, including the civil society. It was like a large consensus, but it did not have the details. And you know, the devil is in the details. So that we're working on the details, what we call special arrangements. And within those special arrangements, that's the one that makes now into motion the implementation of the agreement. So we are at that level. Discussions among politicians were going on how best they will implement every single clauses of the agreement itself. So of course, this has been interrupted now by the death of Tshisekedi. Tshisekedi's death is kind of put on hold the whole discussion process. People want to bury him first and then probably continue the discussion. Others are saying, yes, a committee can continue discussing this arrangement while the funeral ceremony is being organized and the mourning of Tshisekedi is being organized. So that's what I can say now at this moment.
Now, you mentioned the high level of engagement awareness in the Democratic Republic of Congo and the response of the population to these different political events. I wonder if you could say something about that.
The population in Congo is extremely aware about the discussions that are going on among politicians. they are very sensitive on following up these discussions. And this is not coming by luck. It is coming from the fact that people have really suffered, and people are suffering as we speak now. And this process is where their hope is relying. They have invested so much hope in this process to have an opportunity to elect their leaders and have finally a government that they consider to be accountable to them. That's the biggest hope people are investing. Even in the villages, in towns, everywhere, people are looking at this process, this peace accord, that this agreement that the politicians have signed. They are impatient to see it implemented so that they can have the opportunity to vote their leaders now who will lead them. Because suffering is so high, the inflation is very high, the price of basic commodities have increased tremendously, the salaries are meager, so the social difficulty that people are facing are now exponential. This is a fertile ground for any explosion, social explosion that can happen. And so this peace process has been kind of a buffer zone to that explosion, because people have invested so much in this process to see it through. And they hold hope that at the end of it, it will resolve most of their problems. The awareness is very high at all levels. The civil society, even those in the government, many are not really in tune with the government itself. And civil servants, all section of the population, the women, the youth are creating all sorts of groups to voice their concerns. And these groups are everywhere in the country. They cut across political tendencies or regional tendencies, as the dynamics in the Congo are. But everyone is looking forward to see through these discussions and an agreement that was signed on 31st of December. They want to see it implemented. And in fact, they're becoming impatient, because the more people delay the implementation of the agreement, the more suffering people are getting and the more impatient they're becoming. So we hope after the death of Tshisekedi, there will be an acceleration in reaching finally the appointment of the Prime Minister and to see his government now at work, especially in implementing the electoral process up to December this year, if possible.
Right. So you say that the population is really becoming impatient. Maybe this would be a good point to ask you, what role you think there could be for the international community? What role should these international actors play?
Congolese are extremely sensitive about what people think about them. In other words, the Congolese can work inside and trying to resolve their own issues inside, like we are doing now. Because this dialogue is really, really between Congolese without any external kind of interference. Is the CENCO, which is the Conference of Catholic Bishops, who are mediating between the different forces, political forces in Congo. So it's like Congo issues being resolved by Congolese themselves. But that can be a misleading picture, because Congolese also pay, as I said, great attention on what the rest of the world is thinking and what they are doing. In other words, they have friends in the United States, in Belgium, in Paris, in London, in many capitals of the world, where they have relationship, a web of relationship they have built. They may be discussing there and getting advice from the various sources around the world. So at the end of the day, it is not really in Congolese among Congolese alone, but it is Congolese with the web of relations that are outside. And there are many countries that are friendly to Congo, and Congolese are very appreciative of those countries. So they listen to what those countries are saying. The United States, for example, they appreciate the very encouraging and positive involvement, engagement that the United States of America have made throughout this process of discussions, including even the sanction to some individuals within the government were absolutely appreciated by the people. And we can say they have helped also to accelerate the process inside to reach the compromise that many people are enjoying today. The appeasement of the tensions have reduced. The tensions have reduced. And people's hope being put in the process. That is a huge help. So the international community should continue to get engaged, especially now. Especially now that Tshisekedi is dead. Because Tshisekedi was kind of the counter to the government. He was like the one was doing the check and balance with the action of the government. His departure can create a void. That void must be filled very quickly. Nature has an aura of void, you know. The vacuum is not helpful. And in politics, it is even magnified. So that needs to be filled in very quickly by the engagement, renewed engagement of the international community. And I was pleading that the United States should take the lead. Not only because it's the first developed country in the world, but it's a friend of Congo of many years. And Congolese appreciate the effort that the government does, especially of late, bringing in the support, the presence of the special representative, having an effort around MONUSCO, and helping the different resolutions that were done on Congo. They really appreciate the support on the International Conference on the Great Lake Region. Even the Tripartite Plus, if you remember, there was a structure that the United States initiated with this lady, Leader. Leader was the one who was supporting. That was absolutely key to bring the trust building between Rwanda and Congo and Uganda and Burundi and maintained really stability in that region by engaging these different actors from a security point of view so that everyone could be comfortable and not suspect the other. And that helped a great deal to create the consensus that culminated later on with the accord that was signed in Addis Ababa that we are implementing today. So engagement should remain from the international community. Otherwise, political actors will feel like they are now completely left alone and they can do anything and mess up everything. And people can get in the street with all the tensions that we have, can become very uncontrollable with terrible consequences.
Right. So John, what I hear you saying is that contrary to the conventional view, that political actors in Congo are impervious to international engagement, are impervious to that external engagement. You seem to be saying the opposite, because we've seen countries in the region, neighbors of the DRC, who seem to have been very, very isolated from the international community. You seem to be saying the opposite with regard to Congolese actors.
Yeah, and I think these are sometimes the mistakes that the international community make. The international community sometimes makes mistakes by supposing that people are not engaged. People are disengaged. Because some leaders have been labeled in a particular way, then isolation becomes the matter of the day rather than engagement. And isolation, rather than bringing peace, for me, it brings the radical position of that leader who creates more suffering for the people then. But take the case of our neighbors in Burundi. Pierre Nkurunziza was completely isolated. The international community came UN first. Ban Ki-moon himself came to visit Burundi. Nkurunziza did not engage. The regional powers, Africa Union, they sent serving presidents to visit. He did not engage. The regional powers, the neighbors in the East Africa region, they themselves have their own personal interests that contradicted the capacity. Did not give the moral authority to inflict and influence causes in Burundi. Result, they isolated the president. And in all logic, he had no accountability to anybody. So he could do anything he wanted inside the country. In fact, my fear is he may change even the constitution and scrap the time limit. That is a possibility because there's nobody who is engaging him constructively. So that constructive engagement must remain so that the person does not feel completely isolated and hence send him to action that are more radical and more harmful to the community they are serving. But by engaging, keeping the engagement, the person also feels that I'm part of the international community. I can listen to the international community. That's the case in Congo. They don't feel like the international community should come and dictate them exactly what to do. No, that's not what I'm advocating for. I'm advocating for the fact that you keep a line of communication with the people, the actors in the country, so that they can listen. And then you can have influence on them. Not necessarily dictating them what you want, but giving them space to express what they feel. And you express what you feel as an advice you can give them. And let them now interact and filter all the support that you are getting so that they can reach a compromise. And that's what we are really, really wishing in the Congo. Don't isolate them. Engage them. And they can listen. These are people who studied in the US. These are people who studied in Belgium. These are people who studied in Paris and other capitals in the world. They have that sentimental touch to these countries. They want to go to those countries. Nobody wants to be sanctioned. And because of that, the international community have a leverage on the people inside the country and can help them reach a compromise that is beneficial for the communities and the world at large, the international community at large.
Okay, so more engagement and interaction with the Congolese political players.
Absolutely. It is key. It needs to be maintained.